Hey, and welcome back. Today's objectives are to identify the rules for naming aromatic carbon rings called benzenes.
Let's talk about this word aromatic and aromatic hydrocarbons and see exactly what that means. First of all, they are unsaturated, which means they contain double bonds or triple bonds. And then what makes them so special is they have different properties than other unsaturated hydrocarbons. Particularly, those different properties tend to be that they're highly stable. They don't really react with too many other molecules. And the term aromatic was derived because these molecules typically had pleasant smells. Not all of them do, but many of the early ones people discovered did, hence the term aromatic. Lastly, this word benzene ring, which we'll show you shortly what that is. Any hydrocarbon that contains this particular ring, you're going to call an aromatic hydrocarbon.
There are a couple different ways that we could draw benzene rings. The first way is the structural formula. This will take a lot of time, so we usually make line diagrams. You'll see that it's a six-carbon ring that has alternating double bonds throughout that ring. This is called a benzene ring, and we'll be working with these a lot today.
All right, so when you have these benzene-based compounds, there's some special naming rules. First of all, you have to recognize the type of benzene that is the backbone. For right now, all you know about is a normal benzene, so the backbone is just going to be that. And then the next thing you do is name any groups coming off of that benzene. This is done a little bit differently depending on how many substituents are attached. In this case, this would be called mono-substituted because there's just one group attached. And if that's the case, there's no need to number anything because that's the only group the benzene has. So this would simply be called chlorobenzene, this would be called bromobenzene, and this guy would be called ethylbenzene.
Alright, so let's go over disubstituted benzenes. We really just have to recognize the type of benzene, and it's still a benzene, even though we have two substituents coming off of it. In this case, I just put fluorines coming off of each one of these benzenes, because the big thing that we need to learn here is that instead of using numbers when we only have two substituents off a benzene ring, we're going to use letters that stand for ortho, meta, and para, and these letters stand for the positions that they're in. For ortho, they have to be right next to each other. For meta, there's one, it's a 1-3 formation, so we skip one, and then we have our second fluoro. And para means that they're right across from each other, so it's a 1-4 formation. All right, so this is still just another disubstituted benzene. So we're recognizing it as a benzene because that's what it is, and we're going to name any of the groups coming off. We have a bromo, we have a chloro, there's our bromo, there's our chloro, and it's in the M position, so we would simply do M-bromo-chloro-benzene. Something to keep in mind, both of the substituents should be in alphabetical order, so that's why we put our bromo in front of our chloro, M-bromo-chloro-benzene.
So the last example is when you're naming benzenes that are tri-substituted or greater. This means they have three attached groups, 1, 2, 3, like this example has, or more. It could be 4, 5, or 6. You don't use the O, M, or P designations. You just go back to your normal numbers. The general rule is you want to give your attached groups the lowest set of numbers you possibly can. In this case, if we call this ethyl group coming off of carbon 1, then you have to choose, do you want to number clockwise or counterclockwise? In this case, numbering counterclockwise is better because this becomes 1, this becomes 2, and this becomes 4, giving you 1-ethyl-2,4-difluorobenzene, which is the lowest set of numbers you could possibly give these attached groups.
In organic chemistry, we're going to put a lot of different functional groups off of benzenes. And when we do that, they're called something different. So we're going to go over a couple of the ones that we know of that do not require any of the functional groups that we have not learned up to this point. And as we go further in organic chemistry, we'll continue to introduce these functional groups that hang off of benzene groups. All right, special benzene names. This is our first one. It's called toluene. It's just a benzene ring that has a methyl off of it. Anytime you just have one methyl group on a benzene ring called toluene. But what happens if we disubstitute it? Toluene is still going to be our root. It's our type of benzene, so it's going to be toluene. But wherever that other functional group is that's hanging off of that ring, we're going to give either ortho, meta, or para. Meta in this case because we are 1-3 position, so it's going to be M-chlorotoluene. We've checked out a mono and disubstituted toluene. Here's a trisubstituted toluene. Same rules. Here's our toluene with our methyl and a benzene. And then we just have to simply number. It doesn't really matter which way we go because the halide is going to be on the number 2 carbon no matter which way. I would just recommend going clockwise because then it's also in alphabetical order. So this bromo would be 2-bromo, 6-chloro, and then we have our toluene in the middle.
Okay, so here's a different special benzene name called styrene. So if you see the benzene ring with 2 carbons attached and a double bond between those carbons, you're going to call the parent chain for that molecule styrene. Sometimes it looks like this. You could also see styrene written like this. You could also see styrene looking like this. The ring on the inside of the that shape there is another way to designate a benzene ring in case you were confused by that. All the same rules apply. So if you're trying to name a molecule like the one we have here, if it's disubstituted, you want to use the O, M, and P designations. This chlorine's on the ortho position. That makes it O-chlorostyrene.
So we have all heard of polystyrene cups. And there's a lot of protest that goes on about these polystyrene cups because it's hard for them to biodegrade. Polystyrene is primarily used in plastics, and it's just a bunch of these styrenes put together to make a polymer through polymerization. One thing that we have to do is give a shout out to Toby Keith about his song Red Solo Cup, because he lied to you. It takes way longer than 14 years to biodegrade. The correct answer is 100 of years. So when he goes back and rewrites that song, we're hoping that he puts the correct information in there for today's youth.
A different special type of benzene is xylene. You'll see the benzene ring with 2 methyl groups adjacent to one another coming off the ring. If you see that, you're going to call it xylene instead of benzene. To name these, since it's always going to be trisubstituted or greater, you don't have to ever worry about O's, M's, and P's. You just have to assign a number to any attached groups coming off the ring. The 2 methyl groups that make it xylene always have to be 1 and 2. So all you have to decide is which direction are you going to go, clockwise or counterclockwise. In this case, the lowest number you can get is 1 here, 2 there, 3 and 4, making this 4-chloro-xylene.
Our next special benzene is mesitylene, which is 3 methyls going every other carbon around the benzene ring, as shown here. This is the most commonly found benzene when it comes to in different chemical compounds. It's found in over 1 million different chemical compounds. And over here is an example that has bromo off of that mesitylene as well. And we don't need to worry about a number because no matter what spot we place this bromo, it's going to have the same exact numbering sequence. So we could just call this bromo mesitylene.
All right, so coming down to the end here, we have one more special benzene name. This is called naphthalene. Naphthalene is pretty obviously just 2 benzene molecules attached to each other. This has the unique property of smelling like mothballs. As far as naming this thing, you have to pick one of the outside carbons to start numbering on, and then just kind of choose if you're going to go clockwise or counterclockwise from that position. So if I designate this as carbon 1 and decide to go clockwise, this becomes 2. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. Notice we're skipping the 2 carbons that are attached. You're not going to assign them numbers because those carbons already have 4 bonds, so no attached groups can ever attach to them anyways. There's no need to number them. For an example of what this looks like, 2 benzenes attached, so we're going to call the backbone naphthalene. We're going to pick this carbon here as number 1 and decide to go counterclockwise to give everybody the lowest numbers possible. So this is 1, 2, 3, and 4. The final molecule name being 1,4-dichloro-2,3-dimethyl-naphthalene.
Benzene can also be used as a side chain. Anytime that the number of carbons is greater than 6, where benzene only has 6, benzene will become phenyl, which is the name for the side chain of a benzene. So here we have a longer chain and it's heptane, which is 7 carbons. The benzene is 6 carbons, therefore we will have 4 phenyl heptane, phenyl being the benzene off the 4th carbon, heptane being the longer chain of 7 carbons.
All right, so let's summarize today's objectives quickly here. Pretty much what you saw was identifying the rules for naming aromatic carbons benzenes, which includes all kinds of crazy things, styrenes, mesitylenes, naphthalenes. If you have any questions on any of these molecules, please bring them to class.